So welcome everybody. Welcome to the this podcast. This is the Hot Song podcast. The topic this evening is creating heaven on earth. And today is March the 7th, 2024. So what do I mean by creating heaven on earth? So I don't know if anybody is aware of, or if everybody is aware of, but we are actually in a transition, an era where for the past maybe 12,000 years, we've been, or maybe way longer than that, Earth has been hosting third dimension consciousness. And now Earth has shifted into fifth dimension consciousness, and humanity has not shifted yet. However, we are in the process of doing that. So what is fifth dimension? Fifth dimension compared to what third dimension is, fifth dimension could be described as heaven. So when we say, oh, I want to go to heaven, if you have been a good person, then when you die, you go to heaven. So however, when Earth itself has transitioned into fifth dimension, that means we have the option of not needing to check out or die or drop our body in order to go to the fifth dimension. We can actually, within our lifetime, while being alive, alive and well and conscious, shift ourselves into fifth dimension, which is so we're going to talk a little bit about creating heaven on earth, because this is what shifting into fifth dimension is about, is that we get to transform our own lives from what happened before into a state of experience, consciousness, and feeling, and that some may call heaven. So we are actually, should you choose to do that while you are alive and well, is to create heaven on earth for yourself. I remember before Franco passed away, Franco Di Nicola, he kind of mentioned that, and there are a few other, I would say, more spiritually advanced teacher has talked about that. Fifth dimension is not a place. It's not, it's not like, okay, I'm in Toronto and I can go to Hawaii, and that would be heaven. So we can not, fifth dimension is not a destination. It's actually a creation. And I didn't quite understand. I didn't really understand what he was talking about. And a couple of years after he passed away, and I've come to the point that I actually understood now. I'm starting to understand what he meant by fifth dimension is a creation rather than a destination. It's not that, okay, we are, today is we're in 3D, so a certain time frame we are gonna all wake up one morning and be in 5D. Actually, I don't think that is what we collectively have agreed to do. Collectively, we have agreed that we are going to take ourselves into 5D, meaning that we are going to create heaven on earth. And that is the one of the way that we can transition into fifth dimension. So that is the topic of discussion this evening. So what did I understand about that? I think it's because before I was still in my head. I was still thinking that, oh, okay, I'm tapping into my soul, tapping into my spirituality, and I'm just going to be in that. But it's actually my understanding now, it's not that. It's not about tapping into our soul. Yes, it is that, but it's not, that's not the focal point. Why did I say that it's not about tapping into the soul, is that my understanding is that the body is within the soul. The soul is not in the body. The soul is not this, little seed that we kind of, host within the body. The body is actually being hosted by our soul. So there is an energy grid beyond our physical body that is kind of still part of what we would call our soul, because it's the ethereal part of us that connects. That's how the soul connects to everything else as well. So my understanding of what the soul is has changed, and this shift has actually given me more clarity. And also, purifying the soul. And I thought that before, I thought, oh, okay, I have to purify my soul. I have to elevate the frequency of my soul so that I can tap into the wisdom of the soul. It's actually not that at all. It's actually the soul is. It is eternal. It is limitless. The soul is so much more than we are consciously experience. But because the body is within the soul, however, even though we are in touch with the soul, however, because there's a lot of density within the body, a lot of density, the body was born in, at least my body anyways, was born in the third dimension. So it has accumulated a lot of programming, a lot of misunderstanding, a lot of emotional or physical trauma that has distorted, so that when the energy of my soul tries to come in because of all the distortion, I cannot see clearly. It's like when there's a light shining, but you put a very thick and opaque piece of glass right in front of the light, not much can get through. And that's what our body is doing, is that yes, the soul has so much wisdom, so much knowledge. However, not much is getting through because the body is still rather dense. So, part of creating heaven on earth is really start to deprogramming the body, because traumas and beliefs are stored in the body. It's being cons all the programs as in beliefs. Let's say believing that, I am this Chinese girl, a certain age, and I have this amount of energy, I mean education, I have this amount of money. So all of that, it's a program. The thing is, my soul is limitless, but I've been programmed from even before birth, because they've been programming my parents' parents, and how many, I lost count how many generations has been telling us that, we are this body, and only what you can see and what you can touch is, and also what you have paid for are yours. And the rest, no, we have been programmed to be very limited. And now it is about letting go of the limits that we have set for ourselves, letting go of all those conditioning that we have set for ourselves, and start to remember that, yeah, we have a body. However, there is a soul as well. And the soul is really what animates the body, because when the soul is gone, the body doesn't quite function. Our body is made in such a way that it needs to partner with the soul, and we are each one of us. When we think of ourselves, we see the body, we have a personality, and all of that. However, there's a lot of all of that is just a sliver of what our soul wants to, of what our soul actually is. And we are so much more than what we can see in the mirror. We are so much more than what we have in our possession. We have limitless abundance, and we have limitless abilities. It's just that we, or at least I, cannot access all of those abundance of everything yet. So creating heaven on earth is really about connecting with the body, truly connecting to the body, and be able to find out what the body needs and what is being held in the body, that we can start to flush out whatever it is that is no longer serving our experience, whatever it is that's holding us hostage, that's keeping us being anchored into the third dimension. When we can let that go, then that's how we create heaven on earth. So just want to check in with everybody. So far, so good. Any questions, comments?
Now it's more clear, like what, like how you can find it, but still I'm missing the link. Like when you're talking, and my mind is going to my body and saying what I'm holding on to it, what I'm holding on to it. So I think I have to dig deeper layers to find out what needs to be clear.
Okay, that's so my notes for this evening. Let me just read that to you all first, and then I will unpack that, because it's not about, I'm not going to talk a lot, even though I've been talking a bit for the last 10, 15 minutes. But my intention this evening is not to talk a lot. It's really more about experiencing.
I see. Is there any, like, how you question answer, like, is there any assignment or like kind of survey where people can say, okay, maybe this is in there or this is not in there, like that, or no?
Something like that. Yep, sure.
Okay.
Yeah, something
Thank
like
you.
that.
Thanks.
So when I say that, creating heaven on earth, I just want to unpack that a little bit. So I thought, I think a lot of us think, and including myself, think that, oh, okay, we have to create heaven outside. We have to create heaven outside of us. So it's about do, do, do. Actually, no. Actually, the first step is to create a state of heaven inside yourself. So the first thing is to really check in and ask yourself, what is heaven for you? What would How would you feel when you're in heaven?
Worry free, freedom, do like spontaneous things, like not really stuck. Oh no, I have to do this, I have to do this. Not like a robotic stuff like I do. Like you get up, you go to work, and you do this, then cook and clean. Instead of that, it should be like, yes, everything else is getting taken care. I'm not saying I'll sit on the sofa, I will still do it, but more worry-free. It's like that's what I think. I am a spontaneous person and to begin with. I do just the spur of the moment. I do have a flexibility even at work too. Now I'm kind of stuck for like 2, 3 weeks because the circumstances at the site. Other than that, mostly I am free. I am flexible, not free. I'm flexible, but I would like to be free and more joy in the life instead of the that do this, do this, do this, do this. I think that will be heaven for me.
For me, heaven, when I went to Dominican and it was all inclusive, and you feel happy and healthy and everything for you, and every day like holiday. Oh, it's nice. It's a heaven on earth. And you know that everything okay. And you're joyful. You experience like you have joy every moment. This is a heaven.
Okay, excellent. So at least you know what heaven feels like. It's a start. So the next thing is you have to So if you know what heaven feels like, then whatever it is that is preventing you from feeling, from having the state of heaven, is what it is that you need to look at. If you think that, okay, I have limited resource, so that's why I have to worry. Then you need to look at why you believe in that you are limited. Because being limited is a belief. We actually are limitless. So all of that mind programs, those are the things that you need to look at to get to the point where you understand that you are limitless. And the other thing is, if you have anything in your body, illness, pain, for example, then look at those things, because when you're in the right relationship with your body, when you're in the right relationship with your soul, your body will start to heal itself. And if there is a mismatch in what your soul wants you to do and how in your relationship with your body, then that mismatch will manifest as either something is not right with the body or something is not right with work or relationship. So, because everything around you is still a part of you. Everything around you exists to be a mirror for you to understand something.
about yourself. We're not here, or I should say, the only reason we are here is because there is something we need to look at in our understanding. And if we understood everything, if we have resolved everything, then we don't need to be here anymore. We can go back to the spirit world. If we are here, if you are here in this playground, then you know that there is a mismatch. So what is it that your soul wants you to look at in this lifetime? So look at those areas, especially if you feel that there is, if you feel constricted, because the previous couple of weeks I've talked about how enslavement, the idea that we are not free, the idea that we have to do something, the idea that we don't have enough, all of those is actually just an idea. It's an idea that has been repeated so many lifetimes through the lineage, through our own past lives as well, that when we come in this time, we didn't even question it. However, because we are shifting the timeline now, so this is when we need to ask the question, what is holding you back? What makes you feel like you are not free? Because those are the things that you are actually here to look at. And when you really start to look at it and start to dissolve those pre-programming, then you will start to be able to access the original pattern, which is that you are free, you're limitless. So now you know what you need to look at, get a better sense of what you need to look at.
Not that easy. Not that clear.
Yeah, how do you know that what your soul wants you to do? Maybe it's from your mind.
Okay.
I don't know what my soul wants me to do.
Yeah, I know. We don't always know what our soul wants to do. But there are people who does know what the soul wants to want us to do. There are people that, however, not everyone knows and not everyone need to know. So, however, what actually happens is that when you start to heal yourself enough, so you just have to look at what's in front of you in your life. And also, what look at what is taking you away from this state of heaven. Because yeah, when we meditate, we bring in pure love, we bring in connection with the highest frequency self, which is pretty much like I feel blissed out whenever I do that. So that is really the state of heaven for me. Can I maintain that, you know, even when I'm not meditating? No, unfortunately, I'm not there yet. So that's what the things in my life currently that is keeping me away from being able to access that state of heaven, of being in heaven, is what I need to look at and start to heal, start to peel back the limitations that I have taken on. And when I start to do that, then I would start to heal myself And when I start to heal myself enough, like especially if there's things wrong with my body, just like my hip has been giving me some feedback lately, let's put it that way. So I've been really looking at paying more attention to the part of my body that is not doing so well. And when I start to connect and do things and take care of my body in such a way that it can start to heal itself. And when I do enough of that, when you are able to heal enough of your body and also the experiences that you have with people in your environment, when you've healed enough of that, then what usually happens is that your soul will know, oh, okay, Winnie has been a good girl. So she has been doing her homework. So that means that she is ready for the next phase. So then your soul would arrange so that the next thing that you need to look at would appear in your life. And then when I overcome that, then I know, okay, the universe will say, ah, good girl, Winnie. So now we will give you the third thing that you have to work on, and the fourth and the fifth. So that's how it actually works. We don't have to know what our soul's intention is. When you do the work of healing your environment, like environment meaning, you know, the people that you, like, let's say having a good relationship with your family, having a good relationship with the people that you work with, having a good relationship with your body. That's what I mean by environment. Of course, there's also the environment out there. However, we have to do the things that is within our circle first. When we have done enough of that, clearing, healing, then the next thing would show up. And that's how our soul guides us. So you don't actually need to know anything. You just have to do the work, is heal yourself, heal your relationship with the people around you. And when you have done those work, then your soul would create the opportunity for the next step to drop in front of you. Does that help?
Yes.
So I, like you said, we are carrying this over and over. So our relationship or even the colleagues or whatever the relationship we have with work or with people, so we are carrying it from so many lifetimes, right? Now this is, like for myself, I have maybe a little bit awareness taking these classes. So now I know I have to clear that from my field. I make peace with that, though, a situation where however it is, or just disconnect with it. Is that how it works?
So you ask yourself, what is the, if you can disconnect with it, sure. And then if you can't disconnect with it, you have to ask yourself, what is the highest frequency way of interacting with this situation or this person?
Mm-hmm.
Because not everyone you can escape. Family members, you cannot escape unless you decided to cut yourself off from all family. So That's, and also think of it as the people in your life, whether it's from work or family, that is really triggering you. They are precious because they are the people that is actually letting you know that there is something in your understanding of relationship with life and relationship with your body and also relationship with everyone else that is out of place. It is because there is a mismatch. That's why when you talk to certain person, you get triggered. When people of certain energy approach you, you get triggered. That's because there's still something that you haven't quite work out the highest frequency engagement yet. So those are the people that is actually the people that triggers you, actually the people that is lovingly showing you what you need to look at. So don't kill the messenger, please.
I don't know, lovingly or whatever, you know. Like my son loves me so much. I know that. But he's the one who triggers me so much. And it's, what did I do with this kid, really? I disconnect. And then he will say, no, mom, I connect. I don't know what's there. But yes, he's the one who triggers me most of the time. And then I said, I love him so much. He's a good kid. And why I don't like his few habits, it's not much, it's not a big thing. I want him to be like scheduled, you know, sleep early, take care of yourself, put yourself up first, not anybody else. These three things I ask, but no, he's out there for everybody else. He doesn't take care of himself. And he doesn't sleep on properly or on time. So that's what it triggers me. So from there, I don't know what I can really change. So then
that's
I say,
his life, huh?
Yeah, then I say, no, Nish, that's the way he is. Leave it. But still, no, he's my son. And he knows better. And he should be doing the right things.
His life. You have to let him live his life.
No, I'll let him live his life. He's not like, we are not stranger, and I don't really hold him like 100% under my thumb or anything. Just these two things. Other than that, I don't care what he does.
But still have expectations. Your expectations are triggering you. It's your expectation. It's not his fault.
Probably, maybe.
Think about that. Winnie, so where does the brain fit into this soul and body picture? You're saying the body is inside the soul, right? So what is the brain spot then?
We think that we can think. We can think. There is logic, but most of us don't think. I am not joking. Most of us don't think. We react. We do not analyze. We do not... Because most of us are incapable of thinking. We are too triggered.
I don't think. I'm this action-oriented person.
Yeah, most of us don't think. We think, but actually there's not a whole lot of thinking going on. what our brain does is, so there is consciousness, and then there is the brain. They are two functions. What the brain does, the gray matter in the physical gray matter is, as far as my understanding, is actually a receiver. It, like when I think of something, let's say when I think of, I don't know. When I think of, what am I going to do tomorrow, for example, when I think of that, then what happens is the brain will start to go and scan, okay, all of the activities is related to this label called tomorrow. It's going to start to grab those information in. So it's going to receive it. It's kind of like our brain kind of focus. It's kind of like like Google. So it
like
depends.
Recorder.
It's a receiver. So it kind of, when we want to, when we think, okay, I want this or I want certain experience, then it will sift through all the, experiences or things that's not related to them, and only bring the information that we are interested in knowing to us. So in a way, it's kind of like Google, but it's way more sophisticated, okay, because it does not just do that. It actually also, it's depending on our consciousness as well. So if I am a 3D consciousness, then it will bring the 3D related things to me. And if I have a higher consciousness, it can actually access a higher frequency of information to bring in. So in this way, the brain is a receiver. It receives the information that is going to assist us in creating the experience that we want.
But that experience is also what we have already had. It only can, it doesn't give you new information, does it? It only goes back to what it's experienced.
Not necessarily.
No? Okay.
We think of ourselves as being, we are this separate person. Winnie is a separate person. And you are a separate person. Each one of us a separate person. We think that, okay, but no, we're not separate. We all are living in a share. There is a shared environment called humanity. So when I think of something, I'm not just bringing in what is in my experience. I can actually bring in everything that is from that collective consciousness as well.
Okay.
So I can. Not everyone would want to do that. But should we want to do that? Yes, we totally can. And we do that very unconsciously as well. So when I say what I want to do, tomorrow, for example, there can be things that showed up that I have never tried before. I may see it on, Facebook. I may see it on Eventbrite or somewhere else on the internet will show me, there's an art show about, something that is totally outside my sphere of experience as well. So that can happen.
That's coming from your consciousness.
It's coming from the collective conscious, not just my conscious, because we...
It's not just the brain, I'm saying.
The brain can receive information that is not just my story. It can also access the collective as well.
Yeah,
I agree with that. I agree with that. There are certain things I will see that I said, I never thought about it. Yes, I'll do this. I don't know
Yeah,
how it,
that's what I'm
yes.
saying. That is basically, it's your awareness gets triggered there when you see something different. But you got to see it to know it, that it's, that's what you wanted, or that's what you could try. If you are not aware of it, it's coming from somewhere. That awareness is coming from outside the brain.
Vinny, can I ask you a question?
Let me just let me just finish with Roxana. There is there are things that you can tap in. Your brain can receive the information, even though it's completely outside of your own experience. If you're open to it, not everybody is open to it.
I'm always open to it. Yeah.
I remember one, I forgot what it was. I remember one time I was I saw something on the internet. It's about these discs that has been these stone discs. I think it was stone discs, like round discs. And there's been some like archaeologists was trying to, you know, figure out, you know, what are these discs used for? And so I was just tapping into, like, I saw a picture and I was tapping into, okay, so what is, what are these discs used for? And then all of a sudden I have this download about a place in, I think it is in China. It's so it's about a UFO site. So that download now, is that true or not? I don't know. I've not been to China, that particular site anyway, so I cannot verify. I cannot actually verify. But if I'm open to it, then yeah, I do get download.
But you could get a verification through Google or something, huh?
It's not a site that is well known. So, and I don't know the name because I only saw vision of it. I didn't see the name of it.
Okay.
So, and I remember also when like one of Sifu James was trying to get us to do astral projection. I went to, so, you know, we're supposed to go to, we can go anywhere as astral project anywhere we want. So I decided to go to Egypt because, just because that's the kind of person I am. I was walking around the big pyramid on Giza, and I actually was able to know that, oh, okay, that site, even to this day, is guarded by a lot of spirit people, because I saw them there, standing there. They were scouting, you know, and one of them actually followed me back. So, and so that's, are you interested in downloading that?
Of course, but I don't recognize how, even if I download, I will say, I question, am I imagining? Is that what it is? Am I hallucinating? Am I going to be, you know, one of those, the cuckoo bird person? I do put a kind of blockage. So I have to come on, like, move on a little bit further. Say, no, forget it. Just trust. I think I lose a little bit trust because I question sometimes. No, Nishi, I think it's just your own mind-made thing, like your stuff, and you're just going there, you're thinking. It's not reality. So then I don't go further. That's where my barrier is. I don't know what it is, why it is, but it is.
When the mother is pregnant with the child, the body is being formed. Then when does the soul come in? Or is that the soul being started?
Okay. When does the soul come in? It depends on the it really depends. The soul can come in at any time.
That is still a physical body being formed, and then the soul comes in. You're saying the soul,
okay,
the body is inside
when
the soul,
you
so
say
that's why.
In, when you say but, come in, I just want you to know that the soul can come in at the time of conception. And even before that, and even before that, because the soul already knows the possibilities of that. Okay, these two are going to get together and they're going to make a baby. So the soul already knows that that is a possibility.
And it has chosen that couple to be with.
So the soul, but what you're asking is when the soul actually stays for good. Because the soul would come in and it goes out. Because, you know, it's just a baby in the womb. It's not doing anything. So it does not need a soul to be there, you know, 24/7. So the soul would come in, check, and then go out. If it needs to, it'll come back in and then it'll go out and do other things. So,
until the actual birth?
Okay.
This idea about you.
We're going on a sidetrack, right?
Yeah, don't ask me this.
I'm trying to figure out how the soul, the body is in the soul. Because all along we thought the soul was coming to the body. Now the whole thinking is reversed.
Within the woman's body is actually a portal for the child's soul to come through into this reality.
Okay.
Because the soul exists out there, different playgrounds. So within the mother's womb, there is this portal for the soul to come in to be connected to a body.
And each soul is unique.
Some souls are unique.
Oh.
Some souls are unique. Not every soul is unique. And some.
So in the collective, there are still different souls, right?
So what do I mean by some souls are unique? I'm just saying that there are non-players, NPCs.
Okay.
So those are not unique. There are players and then there are non-players. So a player will have a unique soul. Yes. Non-players, not really.
Okay. But that's very few of them, hopefully.
What was that?
The non-players are much less, like.
No, it's more.
I would not say that they are less. They are here to do a different role. To play a different role and not less. They are still eternal essence. It's just that the non-players have several, or maybe I don't know how many could be. It could be, I've heard maybe, 10, 100 people, depending on the soul.
Mm-hmm.
It could be all of those 10 or as big as 100 or maybe even bigger bodies is actually within one soul. So they act. They do not have, they do not really have a free will like we each one have, that we can, do something that is completely different.
Right.
Whereas those group of body would behave as though they were one.
Wow.
Because they were actually controlled or being, or they are receiving the instructions from the same soul. That's why they are not unique. They don't have a unique soul, but they play a very different role than us, than people that have unique souls.
So they're basically like robots. No.
No, they're not robots. They're not robots. They just don't have a unique soul. They are here to play a different role. Just like angels, they are not lesser or higher. They're just here to play a different role.
All right. All right. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Let's go. Over. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So, sorry. Go ahead, Tatiana. Question.
So, I wanted your more explanation. You told that to heal a relationship, like with whoever, with your relative, with your friend, you have to ask what's the highest frequency of engagement. I need more explanation. I didn't get it.
Okay. First thing first, heal yourself. Okay, so don't try to heal relationship with someone else. Heal yourself first. When you're in your body, feel love for yourself. Like everybody just in your body right now, feel love for your body. Each time you breathe in, just bring in pure love for yourself. And give your body full permission to feel loved, to feel safe, to feel taken care of, to really feel it, not just think it, but feel it in the body. Feel that you are completely surrounded by love, a blanket of love, pure love, no judgment whatsoever. Whatever you think, however you look, whatever you do, whatever you don't do, it doesn't matter. You're just surrounded by pure love. Feel. Allow yourself, give your body permission to feel that. Wherever it is in your body that you feel any misalignment or any pain, just love the pain as well. Love your body, even if it gives you pain. And if you don't know what a body being loved unconditionally feels like, just imagine. What would the body, what would my body feels like if it were loved unconditionally? What would that feel like? Show me, body, please. And if you feel any part of your body is kind of resisting this love, then simply love that part even more. If you feel any other feeling besides love within your body, just tell your body that in this moment, is it okay to simply allow the love feeling to come through? Let your body know that in this moment, it is completely safe. You have a roof over your head. You have all that you need in this moment. Let your body know that it is safe in this moment. Safe enough for your body to feel completely loved. Take a deep breath in. Let it all go. And everybody come back. I would highly suggest everybody to do this.
Like send love to yourself? To your own body?
Yep. This is the easiest way I know of to create heaven on earth. Because this body is actually made from the same material that Earth is made of. So we each one actually have a piece of earth within our body. And if you want to be in heaven, it's within your grasp. Treat your body. Love your body. Take care of your body. Turn your body into heaven for you, for yourself to experience.
That's what I felt after this short meditation, like deep peace.
Within our psyche, we've been conditioned that we need love. We need someone to love us because we have been conditioned that if nobody loves us, we'll die. This fear of death has been driving us to seek love outside ourselves. Watch the relationship that you see outside is actually the relationship that is within your body. You cannot control how other people treat you, but you can control how you treat yourself. So heal that first. Heal your relationship with yourself first.
Thank you, Vinny. Thank you.
She just said, Vinny, even though the body got triggered due to somebody else saying something, so I'm trying very hard to heal myself. I have this shoulder pain, and every night around this time, it starts again. I kind of sorted out the situation with the person. It's not completely balanced, like the relative. So I feel like until that gets resolved, I cannot completely heal.
What is it that you want from that person? Like you don't have to answer me, but that's the question that I would ask.
I just want to get back to the balance that we had before, like the relationship.
Okay, the balance.
Yeah, it's starting slowly, but not completely. It's not completely back to the footing that it was before.
Okay. You can't really control what the other person does. You can only control what you do with the situation.
Yeah.
So questions to ask yourself is, what is the best way, or what is the highest frequency way to be with yourself? The way the relationship is in the moment.
So when you say frequency, does it give you a number or something on your...
It's not a number. It's really the most, like within your heart. What do you feel? It's not about the mind. It's about the heart.
Yeah. No, I mean, I'm sending love and everything, like, to the place, and it just gets unbearable that I have to take the painkiller to go to bed. So for a long time, I was not even in touch and I didn't pay attention. As soon as it came into my consciousness, and then she wrote back what happened, then I realized. And ever since that time, I'm going through this pain. I tried to analyze everything else that could have caused it, but then I kind of find what that is, the trigger there.
So send love to that part of your body that actually feels the pain.
Even I'm talking to you, it's getting better and feels good. I don't know how it will be after. I feel the same when I'm with in the meditation with Cornelius also. I feel good at that moment. I completely forget.
It takes a while to balance. So
just keep at it.
Yeah. Just it is a practice.
Okay.
And it's actually all you have to do is just focus on that part of the body and just breathe in pure love for it. And it may get better. And if, because, okay, so it may not be the origin. So where you feel the pain may not be the original, the origin of the pain.
Right. So,
but you work with that first. You work with that first. And then when you have done enough, then the next may show up. I'm not sure. It may or may not be the origin of the pain.
When these things happen, it is the mind that is doing it, right? Because it is our thoughts that create this.
In a way, yes. Yeah, it's
just not physical. I haven't hurt myself anyway, physically.
A lot of the a lot of the physical thing is actually emotional in origin.
Yeah, that's the thing. Yeah,
So that's why bringing in love for yourself, it's love really is a great healer.
I agree 100%. Okay, thank you, thank you.
Okay, you're most welcome.
Thank you guys for being patient.
Yeah, I think I've shared everything I wanted to share. I actually would have liked to have more time to do more of a healing for you, for all of you. First, any other questions, comments first?
No, I'm just going back, like how we get the message collectively. So about maybe three days ago, I bought one of those machines that will tell you how much body fat in your and water and all those things. And so then I promised myself, okay, body, I'm going to be fasting one day a week. So I started that. So I think it's the synchronicity or the message. It is working, yes. Because I got to shed quite a bit from my body.
What kind of machine is that?
It's a weigh machine. They call smart machine. So it's just telling you how much water you have in your body and BMI and body fat and visceral fat and all those things. So No, it was a good thing. So I said, okay, I have the machine now. What I'm going to do with it? Like I see the numbers now, how it's going to go reduced. Triangle, let's see.
Okay. Excellent.